Welcome to worship. I invite you to stand in body and spirit and turn to face the light as it comes into our midst here in the sanctuary. And even at home, I invite you to stand and turn to a candle or a light. It is this turning or reorienting ourselves toward the holy that is the essence of our season of Lent. What we pay attention to is what we are formed by. So let us continue this season of listening, of hearing that still small voice and finding within our own true selves. We often have a cast of characters living inside of our heads that love to carry on an endless conversation, each from their own perspective. The chatter of our minds can sometimes keep us from a deeper listening. And it's often difficult to understand what is the mystical connection to God. Getting our true self into the chairperson's seat in the committee's meeting does not mean ignoring those voices of fear, pessimism, people pleasing, or accusation, but instead listening intently to them and not letting them bully us into negative action. Letting them in and letting them go is the prayer of the mystic within.
We invite you at this time to sit. To sit quietly in the silence of this sacred moment, in this sacred space, and in this silence, practice being present here. Practice being present to yourself and to God. And if emptying your mind in this moment is difficult, consider this. What if you could spend time alone in reflection on a regular basis? What if you could make friends with yourself? Let's sit in the silence and be present to ourselves and to God in this space.
The daily examen is a technique of prayerful reflection on the events of the day in order to detect God's presence and discern God's direction for us. The examen is an ancient practice in the church that can help us see God's hand at work in our whole experience. I will guide us through this prayer. Cards are provided for you to take home and practice daily, and cards are also available online. For that which then I thought was right, have mercy, God. For that which now I regret, forgive me, God. For that which hence I know not what to do, guide me, God. Come and rest. Come and listen. Know that grace, forgiveness, and guidance are available to you at each and every moment that we turn to receive them. Thanks be to God.
We invite you to stand and join in singing our opening hymn, Christ Beside Me, number 2166. And we also invite the children to come and join Miss Julia in the center aisle so that you may bring forth the light of Christ.
would please join me in blessing our children here with us today and those who are at home by reaching out two hands and saying these words with me. May God bless you and be with you. God loves you, and so do we. Amen. Once there was a person who said such amazing things and did such wonderful things that people began to follow them. But the people didn't know who this person was. So one day they just had to ask them. And Jesus said, "In me you may have peace." Jesus called peacemakers blessed and claimed them as children of God. May we follow Jesus and be peacemakers. Let us honor the light of peace that Pastor Matt is lighting. And children, just the children, if you would please repeat after me. God of peace, help us become peacemakers in your world. Amen.
Light this candle of peace, and we do so proclaiming and trusting that one day the peace of Christ that exists fully in heaven will make itself known fully on earth. We light this candle with this hope, knowing that there is war, that there is violence in Ukraine, and that there are people suffering. We light this candle praying for an end to that violence and longing for Christ's peace. So with this hope on your hearts, you who are at home and you who are here in the sanctuary, we invite you to stand in body or spirit and share the peace of Christ with one another.
Some of the redeemed had gone out on the ocean ships, making their living on the high seas. They saw what the Lord had made. They saw God's wondrous works in the depths of the sea. God spoke and stirred up a storm that brought the waves up high. The waves went as high as the sky.
They crashed down to the depths.
The sailors' courage melted at this terrible situation. They staggered and stumbled around like they were drunk. None of their skill was of any help.
So they cried out to the Lord in their distress, and God brought them out safe from their desperate circumstances.
God quieted the storm to a whisper. The sea's waves were hushed, so they rejoiced because the waves had calmed down.
Thank God led them to the harbor they were hoping for.
Let them thank the Lord for this faithful love. and God's wondrous works for all people.
Let them exalt God in the congregation of people, and praise God in the assembly of the elders.
Reading the scripture in Lectio Divina format, I will read it once, and then we will let that resonate for a bit with some music for the inward journey. As you listen, what words or phrases stand out for you in the reading? Feel free to use the paper in your pew or the bulletin to doodle or write that word or phrase if you wish. When the music is over, we will hear the scripture read again. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you not to think of yourself more highly than you ought think, but to think with sober judgment, as according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with the mutual affection, outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Preserve in prayer. This is what the Spirit is saying to the church. Thanks be to God. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds, so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. For by the grace given to me, I say to everyone among you, not to think of yourself more highly than you ought to think, but to think with sober judgment, each according to the measure of faith that God has assigned. For as in one body we have many members, and not all the members have the same function, so we, who are many, are one body in Christ, and individually we are members one of another. We have gifts that differ according to the grace given to us: prophecy in proportion to faith, ministry in ministering, the teacher in teaching, the exhorter in exhortation, the giver in generosity, the leader in diligence, the compassionate in cheerfulness. Let love be genuine, hate what is evil, hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. And persevere in prayer.
The man slowly crept up the steps. He put his hand on the knob of the door and turned it slowly, 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 when suddenly out jumped a dragon. I know. Thank you. Thank you. So, yes, I know. What a strange way to begin a sermon. J.K. Chesterton is an English priest and author who uses this very short story to speak of how we lose our sense of wonder and awe as we grow older, but not Pastor Matt. And the world becomes more a part of us. He tells this story to three groups of children, 10-year-olds, 6-year-olds, and 3-year-olds. Chesterton concludes that when you tell this to 10-year-olds, their eyes begin to get filled with wonder as the dragon jumps from the door. 6-year-olds, however, would start getting a sense of wonder and awe as the man turned the knob of the door. 3-year-olds, however, begin to react with wonder and awe as the man slowly climbs up the steps. Chesterton's point is that we lose our sense of wonder and praise as we get older. He believes we begin to regain that sense of wonder because as we lose the wonder and amazement from our lives, we lose our ability to recognize and take part in the wonderful and wonder-filled things of God. Paul appeals to the followers of Christ living in Rome to present their bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. The appeal continues with, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your minds so that you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. I hear in Paul's appeal a desire for the followers of Christ to be filled with wonder by the things of God. I hear an invitation to regain our sense of amazement that God is working in our lives. The transformation of our lives, the renewing of our minds, is a story that is unfolding. When is the moment that our curiosity will be piqued? When is it that we will begin to listen and be attentive and discern how God would have us show up in the world? All the while believing that we can offer God our most authentic self. The self we have been created to be is our spiritual worship. Is not always interested in our wonder or even the awe of God. The world is more often bent on cynicism, harshness, even violence and tearing down rather than building up. In the Empire of Rome, Paul knew well the world in which the Jesus followers were living, one that is not all that different than the empire that we now live. The culture of empire demands the inclinations of greed and withholding, of racism and classism, using fear as a tool to separate and divide. There is always an issue that is someone else's fault. Certainly not something for us to find accountability or responsibility for. Blaming is so much more convenient and easier. Our sanctuary, the living sacrifice that is holy and acceptable to God, can easily become polluted by the culture that surrounds us with its unceasing messages of harm. So then Paul appeals, be transformed. Listen to the voice of the sacred knowing that is within you. Renew your mind so that you may discern what is the will of God, finding what is good, acceptable, and even perfect. This inward transformation invites us to look within and find that which we desire to be a part of the world that we occupy. Our inward sanctuary compels us to create an outward sanctuary that is concerned with well-being. With that which is good, acceptable, and perfect. That's what Paul proposes. This sacred knowing that we discern leads us to be counter-cultural. As Jesus followers who desire to create a culture of listening, taking responsibility, acknowledging the wounds of others and caring for their needs. An inner sanctuary that honors the peace found within turns outward to create a peace for others that's willing to apologize, be humble, share, and have deep compassion. This sacred knowing, this inner sanctuary, compels us to be connected to our own inner guidance, our God, and those who share our lives. So have you ever had the experience of someone calling or texting you just when you were thinking about them? Anybody ever had that happen? Okay, all right, I thought so. Or maybe you have had some other connection to a person or innate sense about something. It's just a knowing that you can't quite explain. It might have happened when you felt moved to give someone a hug and they respond by saying, that was just what I needed. Or maybe you sat with someone, listened to their troubles, And you shared with them just a few words of comfort, and they responded, "Thank you. That was just what I needed to hear." Or maybe you had a gut feeling about a decision that you needed to make, and you went with your gut, and it all seemed to work out just the way that it needed to. Or perhaps you've offered an apology long after the transgression, and the one that had been hurt or offended said, I've been hoping that you would say that." It may happen more often than we realize. It may only happen occasionally. We may still be waiting for it to happen, but hopefully you have experienced these moments in your life when there is this unexplainable sense of just knowing. It is a wonder, and often wonder-filled. It is a discerning of how and when God is present in your life, leading, guiding, and showing the way. As people of faith, we might refer to these events and our responding behavior as inward guidance. This guidance is intuitive and encompasses the belief that God guides us through our inner impressions. "I have a gut feeling" can often be thought of as "I have a gut feeling about how God wants me to respond, behave, decide, or commit." We have a personal, intuitive feeling or response that is often immediate, without a great deal of reflective thinking. Blaine Smith writes in the book, The Yes Anxiety, that psychologists observe that much of our mental process goes on subconsciously. When we experience an intuitive insight, an inspiration, a hunch, a warm feeling, or instinctive urge to do something, it usually indicates that our conscious mind is reading what our subconscious mind is thinking. This insight can be critical, for our subconscious often processes information better than our conscious mind does. Our intuition then is telling us what underneath we most want to do or think we really ought to do. It's our best insight into what we perceive God wants us to do at this time. Our intuition, that gut feeling, that inner guidance is an important way of knowing God, of having a sacred understanding. Now, for some, this intuitive way of living is much easier. It may even be a spiritual gift or an inclination in personality or based on studying human behavior very carefully. For others, intuitive living takes work and must be practiced. And it may be necessary to lean on those who are a little bit more intuitive. But all of us can identify with that which is most precious. Sacred can mean something religious or spiritual or something set apart, but it can also mean something that one cherishes, treasures, finds precious, or that to which one is respectfully, even reverently dedicated, such as loyalty to one's life partner, peace and justice, old growth redwoods, food for the hungry, or the smile of a child. Part of sacred understanding is knowing what is most precious in your life and what deserves your protection and attention. Just imagine how bleak your life might be if your life did not contain those things. Imagine if nothing was sacred to you. Remembering, discovering, and acknowledging what is sacred. If you commit to this idea, there are things that stand apart in their significance to you. That is why it becomes so important for us to create rituals in our lives. It's why we practice Holy Communion time and again in our community of faith. We come
to the table, to be reminded of the wonder, the mystery of God becoming flesh and loving us so much that Christ would offer his authentic self to be beaten, crucified, and raised again, so that love would win and will win. The mundane or simple rituals of life are so important as well, because it transforms our inward being. Think of those date nights, or walking in the woods, or having one peaceful moment. These are all ways to say yes to life, yes to God, and to the knowing that what we are experiencing really matters and deserves honor, protection, and care. This is all a part of sacred understanding. It's a part of making room for the wonder of God to move in and through all the cycles of life, the endings, the beginnings, and every day, every precious day of our life. Sacred understanding is that intuitive feeling, that intuitive knowing, that gut feeling, that willingness to follow your inner guidance. Sacred knowing is also being willing to be open to the wonder of God, the surprise of God, the transforming power of God. Sacred knowing is being aware of what is most precious in your life and not taking it for granted. Sacred understanding is heeding the call that grows within us to change our plans and seek what really matters the most. Or as the psalmist tells us today, it is God leading us into the harbor that we had hoped for. We need to have a life of wonder, a life full of the wonder of the things of God. We need to have a sense of wonder at the things of God. We need a sense of surprise at God's work. We need a sense of awe and wonder at God's work. All of this allows ourselves to be transformed, renewed, and to discern the inner mystic that is within us. Parker Palmer writes in Let Your Life Speak, "Mystery surrounds every deep experience of the human heart. The deeper we go into the heart's darkness or its light, the closer we get to the ultimate mystery of God. But our culture wants to turn mysteries into puzzles to be explained or problems to be solved, because maintaining the illusion that we can straighten things out makes us feel powerful. Yet mysteries never yield to solutions or fixes. And when we pretend that they do, life becomes not only more banal, but also more hopeless, because the fixes never work." The idea of being a mystic and discerning our own inner mystic may seem odd for many, and you may find it difficult to embrace. Yet being a mystic simply means consciously entering into a sacred journey. It's what Jesus did in those 40 days in the wilderness. It's what we've been doing each time that we've gathered for worship during the season of Lent, as we've risen in body and spirit to be attentive to the light as it comes into our midst. To be a mystic is taking an inward journey that calls us to be awakened, enlightened, born again. A mystic is one who senses that there is more to life than making a living or serving the world, even though these things are good and necessary. A mystic is one who has an insatiable sense of curiosity and is concerned with the essential questions of life and desires to be a reflection of God. This season of Lent is drawing to a close. Next Sunday, We will gather for worship and we will celebrate with the waving of palms. We will get caught up in the joy of the Messiah arriving. And then we will quickly discover that the days before Jesus are filled with darkness. Each year we celebrate Holy Week because we need to remember. We need to attune ourselves to a sacred knowing that death is not the end, that resurrection is possible, and that love triumphs. Today, we come to the table to be renewed and to be transformed by grace. We break the bread and we pour the cup to rejoice in hope, to find patience in suffering, and to persevere in prayer. We come to dedicate ourselves to the transformation that is the kingdom of heaven. May it be so. Amen. All are welcome to the meal that Jesus hosts. There is no one here who is ineligible or unwelcome. No one who is too old or too young. No one who has too many doubts or too few beliefs. You, who are a part of God's creation, are welcome to receive Holy Communion this morning. You may come down and forward through the center aisle, taking a piece of bread and a cup of juice. And then please move to the baskets on the side. Pull your mask down and receive communion, and then put it back in place as you place your cup in the basket. Gluten-free bread is available at each station. And then you are invited to visit these prayer stations that we have had front and center all Lent long. You may pray at the communion rail, or write a prayer on the prayer quilt, or light a prayer candle, blow bubbles in the name of the Holy Spirit. Let us now join together in the liturgy of Holy Communion. The Holy One be with you and also with you. Open your hearts to the one who is love. Let us give thanks to God who gives us courage. To the one who calls us to lives of service, we give thanks and praise. From our beginning, you shaped us to lives in service to one another and all of the earth. You set us in the garden to co-create life with you. You surrounded us with creatures and creation that depend on our care. Our destinies have always been wrapped up in one another, and our individual well-being bound to the well-being of all. Therefore, we join our voices with your people on earth and all the company of heavens, singing praise to you.
That just felt right, right? Amen. Gracious one, we struggle with spirits of fear and greed that tempt us away from your original plan for us. We excuse ourselves from responsibilities to our neighbors. We struggle to believe we have anything to offer to the whole. And at times we knowingly do harm to others for the sake of our own, again, for our own gain. You know our struggles, O God. And so you sent us Jesus. In Jesus, we learn how to show up for one another. Jesus lived in service to collective well-being. He sought out those in need of community. He befriended the ones who were isolated. He challenged the structures that destroy. Through Jesus' life, you taught us the same capacities live in us. We too can choose the way of service to collective life. You have given each of us gifts to play our part. The same spirit of courage that kept Jesus proclaiming love even in the face of death lives in us. On the night of his arrest, Jesus shared a meal with his companions. He took bread, blessed it, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the meal, Jesus took the cup, blessed it, and shared it, saying, "This cup that is poured out is the new covenant." And so in remembrance of all you have done to save us, we proclaim the mystery of our faith. In this cup, sustenance for our Lenten journey. By your grace, may we experience anew the call you place on our lives to serve one another. And feasting at your table, may our hearts be filled with courage once again to follow Christ, come what may. In collective longing for a taste of your kingdom on earth, we join together in echoing the prayer of Jesus. Our Creator, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Would our servers please come forward?
Thank you.
Would you join me in this prayer of thanksgiving? God, your bread and your cup renew our spirits. No matter the times we have failed to show up to your call, or to our own needs, or to the cries of our neighbors, you receive us again. May your unending grace be our foundation as we journey with Christ towards justice. Amen. And would you please stay in a place of prayer with me? God, for all of the prayers in this space, for those spoken and unspoken, we know that you are the God who bends down low to the earth and hears us. We specifically lift up today prayers for positive results for a granddaughter beginning chemotherapy, thankfulness for Kathleen's health, peace for family members, peace in Ukraine, traveling safety, gratitude for thoughtful children, healing and perseverance for loved ones. And we lift up all who are longing for mercy and for restoration, all who stand in gratitude and awe of your presence and your love and grace in their lives. And with all of this, we give you thanks. Let the people say, amen. Nope, that's not going to work. Never mind. Why do I try? Okay. Friends, as we have received the grace of God in this place today, we invite you to respond to that grace. To respond to that grace by giving to God's work in the world through this local church. There are several ways that you can give. You can give online. Online, you can also learn about how to text to give. If you are here with us in worship today, you can leave your gifts, your offerings in the baskets outside of these doors when you leave. And we just invite you to give in gratitude for the grace that you have received in this place. I want to share a few things regarding our shared life together. And then in a moment, I'm going to invite Chris Stamper to come and share some things with us. But first, you may notice at the end of your pew, there are some small postcard-sized connection cards. And I want to invite you to fill those out and leave those all in the baskets when we leave. Sure, in the offering baskets. One of the things that we need to pick up on as we are, you know, reopening and coming back to some version of normal is keeping better track of one another. So if you have been here many times or for years, or if you are visiting, if you could take a moment for those of you who are in the sanctuary to fill out those cards so we can be in touch with one another and know who's here and know who's not. And those of you who are worshiping from home, we invite you to go to the Connect form that is on our home, can be found on the homepage of our website. Other thing I want to lift up is that Pastor Julie will begin a new members class on April 24th. So if you would like to know some more information about that members class, you can send her an email or find her and ask her more about that. But that will go through May 22nd. And then the last thing that I want to lift up is Pastor Julie mentioned the way in which we will celebrate together with palms in our worship next week for Palm Sunday. But I also want to remind you that there will be a collective community service before worship out at 9:45 out in Bronson Park. And those who participate in that brief liturgy will then be invited to lead the way of the procession to begin our worship here in this sanctuary. So if you want to be a part of that Bronson Church community worship experience, that'll be out in Bronson Park next Sunday at 9:45. That's all I have, but I want to introduce Chris Stamper, who's going to give us some good news and some updates on the work of the Dream Team. Thank you.
Thanks, Matt. Good morning. For those of you who do not know me, I'm Christina Stamper. I have the privilege today of representing the Dream Team. As many of you know, we began our campaign almost 3 years ago now to help address the affordable housing issue in Kalamazoo. We have accomplished much, and we will provide details about this over the next few months. While we hope to continue to maintain relationships with our partner organizations long into the future, this summer we are winding down the financial portion of our work. Today, I am here to thank those of you who have given so much toward this effort in your time, in your prayers, and in your financial gifts. I'm also here to encourage those of you who have not taken the opportunity to be a part of this life-changing campaign to join us in creating additional affordable and safe housing options. I especially would like to tell you that we have the chance, if we raise enough in additional funding, to provide a fourth transitional house for the YWCA. Recent data estimates that about 30% of all homelessness in Kalamazoo is due to domestic violence. The house we could help the YWCA purchase would be dedicated to women and children who have experienced domestic violence situations and is a way for them to experience a safe home environment. All gifts will make a difference for somebody's life. So if you have not given to the Dream Fund, please consider doing so. If you have given, please consider your circumstances and if it would allow you to give more. We hope to raise an additional $50,000 to $60,000 or more through this summer to support the purchase of this additional house. If you have any questions or you would like more information, please see the bulletin board right outside the sanctuary dedicated to the Dream activities. And thank you for listening and supporting the dream of affordable housing for all.
Friends, may we find the road that leads to life. May we take the turns that bring right relationships. May we journey with God as we walk in peace. Let us join together in this sung blessing.
Gracious God, Lord of sin.
Beloved of God, you are mystics. God is speaking in you and through you. Go out into this world and share the mystery and the love of God, for the world needs you now. Let us go. Let us go in peace. Amen.